We're going to begin today a study of the book of Acts. The New Testament is comprised of many different types of literature. We have Gospels, which are accounts of the life and ministry of Jesus of Nazareth. They're not, strictly speaking, biographies. They don't tell us the kinds of things which biographies usually tell us. They are accounts of Jesus' life and ministry from different perspectives. We have epistles. We have a prophecy, an apocalypse, in the last book of the New Testament, the last book of the Bible. And we have one history. Many church histories have been written since the first church historian, Eusebius, lived in the 4th century A.D., In our English language, we have a great 19th century church history by a man called Philip Schaff, who wrote several volumes of church history. In the 20th century, we have a great multi-volume church history by a man called Kenneth Scott Latourette. Most years, there's a new church history written by somebody somewhere every year. There's certainly a church history written every decade, written every 10 years. But there's only one inspired church history. There's only one church history written by God Himself, written, inspired by God the third person, God the Holy Spirit. And that is the fifth book of the New Testament, the book of Acts, normally called in English the Acts of the Apostles. Someone has said perhaps we should call the book the Acts of the Holy Spirit. It's the account of what God continued to do, what Christ continued to do through His Holy Spirit after His body was no longer on earth, after He ascended to be with the Father in chapter 1. In this introductory study, I want to share with you five leading themes, five leading features of the book of Acts, five things that the book of Acts is doing. And in the middle of these themes, we're going to talk a little bit about Luke, the author of the book of Acts. First thing that we need to understand is that Acts is the recording of history. There's a man in America called Charles Colson. Here's what he wrote. The Christian faith rests not merely upon great teaching or great philosophies, not merely upon the charisma of the leader, not upon the success of raising moral values, not upon the skill or eloquence or good work of its advocates. Christianity rests upon historic truth. When you read a fable, when you read a made-up story, a fairy tale, it begins long ago and far away. When you read Luke 2, it says these things took place when Caesar, when Augustus was the Caesar of Rome. They took place when Quirinius was the governor of Syria. Not long ago, but on a specific year. They took place in a specific geographical location, in a place called Bethlehem, about 7 kilometers south of a place called Jerusalem, which lay on the far end of the Mediterranean, southeast of Rome. These are real-time events that took place on specific days in specific places. And so one of the great themes is that we have in the book of Acts an account of history. There are those in scholars who have examined the claims of the book of Acts and have found them to be amazingly true. There was a school of history which came out of Tübingen in Germany in the early 19th century, which decided that really these New Testament reports were not historically accurate. Then there was a great professor in Scotland called Sir William Ramsay. And Sir William Ramsay went on a long journey through the lands of the Bible. He examined the geography. He examined artifacts. he examined inscriptions, and he wrote a great book about it called St. Paul the Traveler and the Roman Citizen. Sir William died in 1939, the year that World War II started. And his conclusion was that there is no historic account of the ancient world, the Greco-Roman world, that can rival Luke's account in accuracy. Luke wrote accurate history. History that we can rely upon. Therefore, the Acts of the Apostles is a work of scholarship as well as a work of devotion, as well as a work of piety. The book of Acts is about the discipling of the nations. It's about how the nations were taught beyond Jerusalem the truth that there's one God who made heaven and earth, and Jesus of Nazareth is His Son. Now, we see this phenomenon taking place where disciples become apostles. What's the difference between a disciple and an apostle? Jesus says in Mark 3:14, that He appointed 12, that they might be with Him, and that He might send them out to preach. Discipleship is when we come near to learn from Jesus. Apostleship is when we are sent out to teach for Jesus. What's the first thing a teacher must do? A teacher must learn. You can't teach unless you learn. What is the first qualification of an apostle? That he be a disciple. The word disciple means learner. The word apostle means one who is sent out. The 12 came close to Christ to learn from Him, that they might go far away for Christ to preach for Him, to teach for Him. And that's what's happening as we see this transition phase of the disciples becoming apostles in the book of Acts. Acts 1:1 says, "This first account I composed." So Luke is talking about his composition of the first account as a historian. Now, the first account was Luke. This man called Luke wrote two books. He wrote the Gospel of Luke and he wrote the book of Acts. He's probably the only Gentile who was one of the contributors to the New Testament. He had three careers. His first career was as a physician. His second career was as a missionary. We see him become a missionary in Acts chapter 16. His third career was as a writer. Now, let's think about Luke. Luke believes that God is leading him to write. First, to write the story of Jesus. He has a friend called Theophilus. Some scholars believe that this friend was a new Christian. I'm not a scholar. I don't think he was a Christian yet, but I think he was very interested. We really don't know anything about him. And I think that Luke wrote his first volume, Luke, and his second volume, Acts, to bring this one individual, Theophilus, to faith in Jesus of Nazareth. Now, Luke is thinking, well, maybe I will write an account of Jesus' life. But think about that for a minute. First of all, it had already been done. Second of all, it had already been done twice by Matthew and by Mark. thirdly, it had already been done twice perfectly. Fourthly, it had already been done twice perfectly by writers who knew Jesus perfectly. Now here's the question. Why should Luke do it again? To help one person. One person called Theophilus, the man who is named in the first verse of Acts. The first account I composed, Theophilus, about all that Jesus began to do and to teach. Now let's ask a question. What if Luke was discouraged by the fact that the job had already been done? The job had already been done twice by Matthew and Mark. The job had already been done perfectly. The job had already been done by two people who knew Jesus personally in the flesh before he was crucified, and Luke did not know him personally in the flesh before he was crucified. What possible contribution could Luke make? What could he add? And yet he committed himself to that task. Why? To help one person. One person named Theophilus. If Luke had allowed himself to be discouraged, if Luke had said, look, I can't do this. Why should I do this? It's already been done. It's been done twice. It's been done perfectly. It's been done by two people who were companions of Jesus himself. One, a disciple, and the other, John Mark, who actually knew Jesus as a young boy. What can I add? If Luke had said that, here's what you and I would not know. We would know hardly anything about the birth of Jesus. We wouldn't know about the shepherds. We wouldn't know about the manger. We wouldn't know the five hymns of Christmas. The hymn which Mary sang that we called the Magnificat. The hymn that Zacharias sang, the father of John the Baptist, which we call the Benedictus. The hymn that the four hymns of Christmas. We wouldn't know the hymn that the angels said over Bethlehem called the Gloria in Excelsis Deo. We wouldn't know the song which Simeon sang with Anna when he met the baby Jesus in the temple, which we call the Nunc Dimittis in Latin, now let our servant depart. We would know nothing about the childhood of Jesus. We would know nothing that happened when Jesus was a little boy. One German scholar in the 19th century said that the childhood of the Lord Jesus Christ is like a beautiful garden with fragrant flowers. But there's a high wall around the garden, and we can't see anything in the garden. But one bouquet, one group of flowers, has been thrown over the wall to us so that we have one little set of flowers, one little bouquet of flowers from the childhood of Jesus. Who threw that bouquet over the wall? It was Luke. Luke, who tells us about what happened in the temple in Jerusalem when Jesus was 12 years old. Luke is the only one who tells us about that. If Luke had not made his efforts to help one person named Theophilus, you and I would not know the significance of the phrase Good Samaritan, because only Luke tells us about the Good Samaritan. You and I would know nothing about the phrase prodigal son, because only Luke tells us about the prodigal son. You and I would know nothing about the ascension of the Lord Jesus Christ, because only Luke tells us about the ascension. Why? Because he wanted to help one person. You see, all the good that comes from a commitment to help one person. You don't need a big church. You don't need a huge ministry. You don't need a large Bible study or a large following. You don't need a lot of people who listen to what you teach. You need to find one person who doesn't know as much as you know, and you need to teach them about Jesus. That's what we call discipleship. And you have no idea the great blessing which can come from that one commitment. Luke had no idea how God would bless his commitment to Theophilus. Now, he's writing a second volume to Theophilus. If you ask most Christians who wrote most of the New Testament, most Christians would tell you Paul. And most Christians would be wrong. Paul did not write most of the New Testament. Paul wrote more books of the New Testament than any other writer. 13 books. 14 if we count Hebrews. I don't count Hebrews. I don't believe Paul wrote Hebrews. And Hebrews doesn't say that Paul wrote Hebrews. But there are more words in Luke and Acts than there are in all 13 of the epistles of Paul put together. Which means that Luke wrote more of the New Testament than Paul did. Which means that we got most of the New Testament from an author who committed himself to help one person, one individual who was probably not a Christian yet, but who was interested in Christianity. One person called Theophilus. The name Theophilus in Greek means lover of God or beloved by God. Whether Theophilus loved God or not, God certainly loved him because he sent him this great friend, this doctor who became a missionary, who became a writer, whose name was Luke. The first account I composed, Theophilus, about all that Jesus began to do and to teach. We see, thirdly, in this passage, the importance of doctrine. We see the Holy Spirit as the teacher of the doctrine. Look what it says in verse 2, until the day when he was taken up to heaven, after he had by the Holy Spirit given orders to the apostles whom he had chosen. We actually see in the beginning of the book of Acts the emerging Trinitarian witness. We see all three persons of the Trinity teaching the church. Notice verse 1. Jesus, what Jesus began to do and teach. Notice also in verse 2. The Holy Spirit gave the orders. Notice verse 4. What the Father had promised. We have the Father, verse 4. We have Jesus, verse 1. We have the Holy Spirit, verse 2. We have this great Trinitarian witness emerging in the doctrine, in the teaching of the book of Acts. We have in the book of Acts, fourthly, the prominence of the Holy the prominence of apologetics. What are apologetics? Apologetics are arguments. Apologetics are proofs that our faith is true. Now, what kind of proof is it? It's not like a proof in Euclid. It's not like the proof of mathematics. The proofs that we have, the arguments that we bring for our faith, are not arguments for mathematical proofs, mathematical truth. It's more like the arguments in a trial. I don't know what the Russian judicial system is like. I don't know how you prove that someone is guilty or innocent in a court of law in Russia. But in America, in the West, we have what we call a preponderance of evidence, the majority of evidence. And if the majority of evidence says that a man committed a crime, and there's no reasonable doubt, we say that man is guilty. If there is a reasonable doubt, we say that that man is not guilty. And the New Testament brings us sufficient evidence that we can say that Jesus of Nazareth is who he claims to be. And we have proof which no reasonable person would doubt. And we see these proofs brought forward in the book of Acts, so that the book of Acts is a work of apologetics. In 1 Peter 3:15, it says, "Sanctify Christ in your heart. Always be ready to give an account for the hope that lies within you for those who to those who ask." That's 1 Peter 3:15. And that's what Luke is doing. He's giving an account. He's offering arguments and proofs. All the sermons and speeches in the book of Acts, and there are lots of them, have unbelievers in the audience, except for chapters 15 and 20. Chapter 15 is the Council of Jerusalem. Chapter 20 is the charge to the Ephesian elders. But all the other speeches and sermons in the book of Acts are directed partially, at least, to unbelievers.
We invite you to participate in the International Bible Teaching and Gospel Sharing Project. Whether these Christian expanded educational opportunities will become available to people around the world depends on all of us. We very much need and value your prayer and financial support. For more information, please visit www.tvseminary.com.
Now, there's another great theme in the book of Acts, and that theme is this: God has to do it. God was doing great things through Jesus of Nazareth, and we saw those great things in the Gospels. God continues to do great things through the holy apostles and through His church in the book of Acts, after Jesus has ascended to the right hand of the Father in power. But the reality is, the apostles can't work in their own strength, and the church certainly cannot do anything in its own strength. There's a hymn written by a Welshman called William Williams, and there's a line in the hymn that says this: "All is vain, all is empty, unless the Spirit of the Holy One come down." And the book of Acts is the story of what happened when the Holy Spirit came down to clothe the church with power to do what Christ had done. As a matter of fact, you could summarize the whole book of Acts in this way. You could say, Jesus went up, the Holy Spirit came down, and the church went out. Jesus went up, Acts 1. The Holy Spirit came down, Acts 2. And the church went out. We come to Acts 1, and Luke is reviewing with Theophilus what it is he's doing. He talks about how Jesus, after he was raised from the dead, presented himself alive to his apostles with many convincing proofs. You see there again is a reference to apologetics. Jesus even exercised apologetics to the apostles. Jesus even proved to the apostles after he was raised from the dead that the things that he was claiming were true. And the apostles weren't necessarily eager to believe him. You remember Thomas did not believe the reports at first. Thomas said he wouldn't believe the reports unless he could actually feel the wounds and the place where the spear had entered his side. And so verse 3 said that he presented himself alive after his suffering by many convincing proofs. And he appeared over a period of 40 days and 40 nights. 40 days and 40 nights after his resurrection, Jesus walked this earth, meeting only with believers in the post-resurrection appearances. Gathering them together, he commanded them not to leave Jerusalem, but to wait. Wait for what the Father had promised, which you heard from me, Acts 1:4. For John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. This is Acts 1:5, Jesus referring to the promise of the Spirit's coming on the day of Pentecost. In chapter 2, 10 days after the ascension. Verse 6 says, when they came together, they were asking him, saying, Lord, is it at this time you are restoring the kingdom to Israel? Now, what is the kingdom? What do you have to have a kingdom? Well, you've got to have a king. You've got to have the commands or the law that come from the king. And you've got to have the people who are subjects of the king, the people who follow the king, the people who obey the king. We will see the kingdom of God when we see people following the king's commands in obedience. And the apostles asked the question, is it at this time that we're going to see that happen in the earth? This question actually brings us to a great controversy in the history of the church, and a history in the history of the interpretation of the Bible. What does the question mean? What do the disciples want to know about this last question that they ever asked Jesus for the ascension? And what does Jesus' answer mean? God willing, we will address that question tomorrow, because now we have to break for the day.
Now he who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will also supply and increase your store of seed and will enlarge the harvest of your righteousness. You will be enriched in every way so that you can be generous on every occasion. And through us, your generosity will result in thanksgiving to God. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 10, 11. How to give to TVS Ministry. You may give online at efta.org/givenow. In the description place, write Russia Distance Learning, account number 24109-0150. Or make checks out to EFCA. Write on the check memo line, Russian Distance Learning, account number 24109-0150. Mail to EFCA Donor Services, 901 East 78th Street, Minneapolis, Minnesota, 55420-1300. Or send your gift through PayPal for tvs.gift@gmail.com.